Welcome to Encounter. I'm Monsignor Jim Vlaun, along with Bishop John Barres, the Bishop of the Diocese of Rockville Center. On July 1st, 2019, Pope Francis formally approved Blessed John Henry Cardinal Newman's canonization, which took place on Sunday, October 13th. The cause for his sainthood was opened in 1958, and he was declared venerable by Pope St. John Paul II in 1991 after his life of heroic virtue was recognized. He was beatified by Pope Emeritus Benedict in 2010. We're celebrating this great new saint for the church, Bishop. It's a big day and a big moment for us, right?
It's an exciting moment because St. John Henry Cardinal Newman has been such a pivotal figure, in the words of Bishop Robert Barron, one of the pivotal players in church history. His conversion to the Catholic Church in 1845 and described in his classic work, Apologia Pro Vita Sua, set off almost a volcano of conversions in England, in the United States of America, and globally since that time in the 20th and 21st centuries.
What I like about him in so many ways is that to this very day, his effect is still felt not only in our church, but throughout universities globally, right?
Yes, his classic work, The Idea of a University, he set forth a vision where God would be at the center of university life and the growth in Christian character, the growth in virtue would be the center of a radically free but connected search for the truth in every discipline.
Now, you attended the Knights of Columbus gathering, which is an annual gathering, and has really become a gathering of church leadership throughout the country and even the world. And even the speakers at these are global speakers. And you encountered this year Cardinal Collins. I think you might have emailed me from the event because it was such an unbelievable talk that Cardinal Collins from Canada gave at this.
The Knights of Columbus Convention is a global missionary experience for the church. And Cardinal Collins's talk on the relationship of John Henry Cardinal Newman's thought on conscience and church teaching was so beautifully, clearly expressed with great charity, with great prayer. It was just a wonderful experience, and I'm so glad that our viewers on Catholic Faith Network are going to be able to see a wonderful section of it.
Actually, we're going to do that right now. Cardinal Thomas Collins, the Archbishop of Toronto, was the keynote speaker at the annual Knights of Columbus State Dinner, and he spoke about the example and teaching of John Henry Cardinal Newman, a light to guide us today. Take a look.
John Henry Newman, who lived from 1801 to 1890, was immensely successful as an Anglican professor at the University of Oxford, and he had the comfort of lifelong security in his position there. He enjoyed the esteem of the rich and the powerful. His future was bright. He was a member of the elite of England. But on October 9, 1845, he gave up all of that and became a Catholic, joining the ranks of the despised losers in society, recently persecuted, and still subject to harassment. He did this because he had the courage of his convictions. Despite his own personal anti-Catholic prejudices, he was convinced by honest study of the scriptures and of the early Christian writers that the Catholic faith was true. In a period of intense prayer and reflection of the early 1840s, he wrestled with the objections he had always had against Catholicism. And he wrote a great book, The Development of Christian Doctrine. When he had finished it, he became a Catholic because he realized that the Catholic Church was right about Jesus, and it was the church that Jesus had established. Catholic teaching was true. Newman always sought the truth, and so should we. In fact, he eventually asked that his epitaph be "From Shadows and Illusions into the Truth." He never could accept the idea, common in his day and very common in ours, that religion is mainly a matter of personal taste. Some prefer this belief and some prefer another, just as some prefer chocolate and some prefer vanilla. No, what matters is whether religion tells us the truth about God and about his will for us. Our life of Christian discipleship must be based on an encounter with Christ in word and sacrament. We need clear teaching rooted in the gospel so as to know the Lord we love. We heed his call to repentance, and he sends us out to proclaim the good news. The sequence of Christian discipleship for each one of us begins with the truth of the gospel, and is powerfully symbolized when the bishop hands the book of the gospels to a person who's being ordained a deacon with these words: "Receive the gospel of Christ, whose herald you now are. Believe what you read, teach what you believe, and practice what you teach." That's the order. We read the gospel, the message of redemption. We proclaim it to others, and then we act on it. We learn from Newman that we need to know our Catholic faith, which is the true guide for our life in this world of ever-shifting, trendy ideas, some of which are as deeply troubling as they are popular. We serve the Holy Spirit, not the spirit of the age. And although Christians need to adapt the way in which they proclaim the gospel faith to diverse cultures in which they live, the substance of Christian faith and life comes from the gospel, not from any earthly society. In fact, the truth of the gospel challenges any earthly society. The Knights of Columbus does a great service in supporting the teaching of the faith, which has come down to us from the apostles and so from Jesus himself, who is the way, the truth, and the life. We need to have the courage of our convictions to profess our faith in a hostile society, as Newman did, and let the chips fall where they may. In Newman's case, he had to leave his beloved Oxford, lost most of his friends, and set out at the age of 45 into an uncertain future. Today as well, many people can lose their livelihood by being true to their conscience. We must be ready with clarity and charity to stand up for our faith in the public square, and that is another way in which the Knights of Columbus serves our Lord and his church. If Newman is ever named a doctor of the church, it has been said that he should be called the doctor of conscience, because he is especially known for his teaching on the nature and primacy of conscience. In fact, when people these days speak of the necessity of following one's conscience, they often refer to Newman, and frequently incorrectly. In 1875, in his letter to the Duke of Norfolk, Newman laid out a masterful explanation of the Catholic understanding of conscience, which has influenced Catholic teaching ever since. He called conscience the aboriginal vicar of Christ, and he even made the joke that if at a banquet he was called upon to propose a toast, he would first toast conscience and only then toast the Pope. People wondered what he meant when he said that. Newman was simply repeating the ancient Catholic teaching that we obviously must always act according to our conscience. Just as obviously, however, we have the responsibility to be sure that our conscience has been formed and informed by the truths of faith and reason. If we do not, we will be operating with a deformed conscience that will lead us astray. In his letter to Norfolk, Newman explicitly rejects the false modern view in which the appeal to the supremacy of conscience is really just a way of trying to rationalize going for what the ego wants. Newman says, quote, "Conscience is a stern monitor, but in this century it has been superseded by a counterfeit, which the 18 centuries prior to it never heard of, and could not have mistaken for it if they had. And that counterfeit is the right of self-will." Though we must certainly follow our conscience, Newman does not mean by conscience a pass to evade God's law and the sharp gospel challenges of the life of Christian discipleship and the insight of reason and common sense to give up all of that in favor of our subjective desires. If we read his great parochial and plain sermons, we can discover a bracing call to nothing less than holiness and obedience to the call of the gospel. In his letter to Norfolk, Newman writes that, quote, "The divine law, then, is the rule of ethical truth, the standard of right and wrong, a sovereign, irreversible, absolute authority in the presence of men and angels." He says that for Catholics, conscience is, quote, "the internal witness of both the existence and the law of God." And so, when we are tempted to do evil, such as abuse of the vulnerable, or abortion, or euthanasia, or other such actions, the voice of a conscience formed in accord with the objective law of God found in Scripture and Catholic faith will shout out, "Stop." An overly subjective conscience will not. The voice it hears will only be the echo of our own desires. It is the counterfeit of conscience, the right of self-will. It occurs to me that there's an application of this in our own time, that in the period from around the late 1960s to the early 1990s, when most of the clerical abuse scandals occurred, this was also a period in which a very subjective view of conscience, disconnected from objective moral norms and absolutes, was being promoted, especially as a way of rationalizing disobedience to humani vitae. For that matter, this highly subjective view of conscience is still sadly prominent in the church. When conscience is seen as a free pass to go along with our own desires and the spirit of the age, then the flame of faith flickers and dies, and the church shrivels away. When conscience is seen as it is seen by Newman.
Now, it's hard to tell exactly, Bishop, the reception that Cardinal Collins received after this talk. I mean, it must have been tremendous, right?
It was. People were mesmerized by it because he was able to show how conscience receives the objective truths of the Catholic Church's teaching. And those truths are integrated in our consciences in a way that, in truth and charity, the truth sets us free. And it not only informs and motivates our conscience, it inspires our imaginations, our hearts, and our daily actions. They need to be objective truth, in Newman's view, is liberating for our conscience, guides our conscience in the light of Christ. The classic Newman prayer, "Lead, kindly light," the light of Jesus Christ expressed in the splendor of truth of Catholic teaching, illuminating our consciences, illuminating our minds, hearts, and imaginations, illuminating our path to eternity.
It's terrific. And we also have a beautiful opportunity when we get back from this quick break. We're going to actually have Cardinal Collins joining us in the studio. So stick around. We'll be back with more right after this. Welcome back to Encounter. We are continuing our discussion on St. John Henry Cardinal Newman and the relationship between his life and theology. And joining us now is Cardinal Thomas Collins, the Archbishop of Toronto. Your Eminence, thanks so much for joining us today. We're so glad that you could be with us.
I'm glad to be with you.
Can you tell us a little bit about how St. John Henry Cardinal Newman has impacted your own personal life?
Well, I've always been very much moved by the story of John Henry Newman, his own life. When I was, I think it was in high school or university, I read Mariel Trevor's two-volume biography of Newman, which really follows the, really, in a sense, the spiritual adventure of his life. I thought, here's a remarkable man, because he really gave up a lot because of his convictions, because of his conscience. So I've always been impressed by Cardinal Newman. And then over the years, I began to read his writings, especially his Apologia Pro Vita Sua, in which he defended himself against accusations that he had been sort of hiding his true beliefs. And it's a masterpiece of English. And when I was writing my own doctorate over in Rome, I would be reading Newman in the hope that with that going through my head, when I would write stuff, it would come out with at least a little of the benefit of his style. I don't know whether that works or not.
There is so much that we can garner from knowing the life of a holy man like that, and you can see that inspiration. I agree with you completely. Can you tell us about what in his life is prominent in your estimation?
Well, I think he's a man of deep conviction. Here is a person who is immensely talented, and yet he gave up this position in the Anglican Church and Oxford University and so on because he truly believed that the Catholic faith was the fullness of faith. And it, you see this in 1845, the time of his conversion. He went away to a place called Littlemore, which is just outside Oxford, with a few friends to really pray and think about what God was calling for him in his life. And in the course of it, he wrote a book called The Development of Christian Doctrine, which he just looked through. What does God want in the history of the church? Where is the church? And by the end of it, he joined the Catholic Church. So I find that to be immensely moving, that someone would follow his conscience despite losing his security, his job, and everything. And I think he also was a person who really touched the hearts of people when he was a preacher. To this day, the parochial and plain sermons, which he wrote when he was preached when he was an Anglican, are astonishing. They're just wonderful.
Pope Francis said that St. John Henry Newman's vision of religion's vital role in society should serve as a model today. What do you think that means in our society right now?
Well, I think that's very true, because Newman was perceptive and an intuitive understanding of what was happening. And even in his day, there was this beginning of a kind of a secularism in the world outside in which he was living. It was a time when a lot of the faith was sort of weakening among a lot of people. Arnold Dover Beach with sort of the faith like a tide kind of going out. And Newman was living in the midst of that. And so he could see a lot of things we're facing now. And yet he realized that it's important for Christians to be able to articulate their faith in a secular society. And so it was important that they themselves be strong and clear in their faith, and also they be able to speak about what is the nature of faith, how can we find the truth that God calls us to. And so I think he showed that in his own personal life. His writings are profound on this too, to help us in our own life. The parochial and plain sermons give us a real honest way of living a Christian life that's got real integrity. That's wonderful. But we also have to reach out to the other people in the world who have lost their faith. And he tries to find ways of doing that. I think that his personality, he would reach out and try to build bridges to people. I think that's very important.
What was St. John Henry Newman's relationship with the university? I think there's a beautiful relationship there that's worth discussing.
Well, that's true. He was always, in a sense, a teacher. He had begun as a teacher, a pastoral teacher, you might say, when he was at Oxford University. He got a position as fellow of Oriel College after, by the way, he sort of flunked out of his exam. He's a brilliant man. He overstudied. He had a kind of a breakdown. And so he didn't get the highest marks in his final exam, but he tried again in a very difficult academic contest. He became a fellow of Oriel. So he was a teacher there, one-on-one with the students. And what he said there was that a teacher must have a care for the pastoral care for the student, not just the brain, but the whole person. Now, the head of the college didn't agree with that, so he cut out all the students from him. He wanted to be just more dry. And so Newman then used the time to study the faith more and ultimately became a Catholic. When he did become a Catholic, he began a school. And again, this was not like Oxford, but it was a little school in Birmingham, England, a kind of elementary and high school. And so he spent much of his life as the head of that little school. But also the bishops of Ireland asked him to come over to Dublin and found a university. And so he founded the Catholic University in Dublin in the 1850s. It was successful in many ways, but it was a failure in others. After many years of frustration, he just went back to Birmingham. And the full university didn't survive very much. But in the course of it, to try to explain what he was about, he gave a series of talks which became what's known now as the idea of a university. And that is the single most important thing ever written on universities. And it is astonishing. And so that vision, which he tried to implement in the kind of political world of Dublin and semi-successfully did, but not completely, that's an inspiration for the rest of us. So he's really the great person that's why I think wisely Catholic groups at universities are called Newman Clubs. And I think that's very important. He really had a profound care for the whole person. And that's what you see in the idea of a university.
Lastly, why do you think St. John Henry Newman is still relevant to Catholics in the world today?
Well, I think we need the example of people of integrity. You can't beat that. He stood for the truth as he saw it. He was a man of conviction. He also spoke about conscience. And I think we need to have a good understanding of that. Everybody, whether it's in the church, in politics, in daily life. And for him, conscience was basically, he said, it's the aboriginal vicar of Christ. It's sort of the fundamental vicar of Christ speaking within us. But it's not just like what my heart wants to do, like I think, because that we can fool ourselves on that. It has to be rooted deeply in faith, reason, revelation. And then conscience is, in fact, the voice of God within us. If it's simply sort of the God within my own self, as Chesterton said, if Mr. Smith thinks he listens to the God within, he's just listening to Mr. Smith. So that's not what Newman meant by conscience. But I think in our age, especially in the church, we need to have a very clear vision of conscience. It is what we follow, but it must be formed. It must be formed in a way that will lead us accurately home. It's a navigation system to lead us home. And if that's to happen, we need to know where home is. We're heading home to the heavenly Jerusalem. And I think Newman gives us a way to come, as he says, from shadows and illusions into the truth.
Your Eminence, this was really terrific. Thank you so much for doing this. I have to remember to send you an Emmy Award when we win one.
It's great. Glad to be here. Glad to be with you.
God bless, and thanks again for being with us. Okay, we have to take a quick break, but we'll be back with more Encounter right after this. Bishop Barres, kind of an exciting program today. I mean, to hear some verbatim remarks from Cardinal Collins as well. What's your thoughts in reflection today?
I think it's around St. John Henry Cardinal Newman's Episcopal motto, cor ad cor loquitur, heart speaks to heart, the heart of Cardinal Collins, speaking historically to the heart of St. John Henry Cardinal Newman and sharing that on Catholic Faith Network and inspiring all of us.
And I hope a lot of people will take the time to come back and watch this again and see it on demand, because there's a lot of good information here and it really is helpful in our understanding of this beautiful man.
And who knows, perhaps we're talking not only about a saint, but potentially a future doctor of the church.
My fingers are already crossed. That's good. That's exactly what I'm thinking, too. Well, for Bishop John Barres, I'm Monsignor Jim Vlaun. We want to thank you for joining our discussion today. For more information on Encounter, you can visit cfntv.org. God bless. We'll see you next time.